We've got a nice full room tonight. This is really wonderful to see so many people out on the first night of the season here. I am Bill Doley, the president and CEO of Archaeology Southwest. And I believe this is year number four, Linda? We're getting old enough that we can't count very more than a couple of hands. This is an archaeology cafe. It is an informal setting, obviously. Archaeology Southwest is a nonprofit. We're based in Tucson. Our mission is to explore and protect the places of our past. One of the research issues that we've been looking at over for a decade and a half is migration out of the Four Corners area down into the southern Southwest. And in March of next year, we will be doing a tour program, and there's a little handout on that tour, and we'll actually get to visit a number of those places that we've been focusing our research on and tracking that migration across the Southwest. So a real opportunity. There's, I think, five or six seats still open on that tour. It'll be a small, very focused tour, up to 20 people max. So about a week, 6 days, I believe, and should be a really good time. One of the benefits of membership in Archaeology Southwest is this quarterly magazine called Archaeology Southwest Magazine. The current issue is on Santa Fe Underground, so it gives you the story of the multiple layers there as you go through the streets there in Santa Fe. And some random person in the audience thinks it's a very good issue. Yes, she's right. Thank you. So, all right. I will not speak for the next hour and a half. Arthur Vokes is our speaker for tonight. Arthur has been at the Arizona State Museum since which year?
1980 is when I started as an adult.
Yes. So since 1980, he has in particular studied more shell artifacts probably than anyone here in the Southwest. And as a result of his interest in shell, often gets to look at a whole range of other items that are high status goods and so on. So he's going to share his perspective and deep history with working with these kinds of artifacts across the Southwest. And again, take it away, Arthur, and we will get a chance to ask questions later. So yeah. I will be back.
So when I was first approached about this, the idea was to do something that was, they said, a big picture concept. And I asked, well, at first I was trying to think about how to put this into a large picture. And I said, well, how about a trade network that runs from South America to Nevada and the West Coast to the Mississippi River? Is that big enough? And they said, yeah, okay. So we went with that. So that's kind of the scope of the trade networks. When you start to put all the links together in the systems of exchange systems. And I'll come back to that in a bit. I wanted to explain in the handout, at the beginning, the first page of the handout, other than the title page, I've given a bit of a framework, a temporal framework. So for people who are not familiar necessarily with how some of the chronological sequences that people talk about, you can kind of see how things align in terms of across the region at various times. So when you're talking about, say, the sedentary period Hohokam, that's also going to be contemporaneous with other types of groups in the Southwest, and particularly how does it relate to, say, Pakame or to the Chaco phenomenon up in the ancestral Pueblo areas to the north. So I figure people can reference to this as we're talking about things to get an idea of what I'm talking about in terms of time depth. Scale of the assemblage, like I said, the scale of these exchange systems, what you're dealing with in with high status goods. They're kind of a distinctive set of material. These are materials that would have been restricted access in most societies. These are things which are going to be related to ritual or to various roles in communities and stuff, and symbols of offices and things. You're talking about things like materials such as exotic materials, such as shell that came in from the Gulf of California or the California coast. It's probably the most common. Macaws and various types of parrots and colorful birds. These were coming from central Mexico and coming up into the system. Other things which would have been cacao, chocolate. And most recently, some work that Patty Crown has been working on has now identified residues which they think is perhaps holly, which is something that grows in the southeast on the coastal plains of the southeast United States. Doesn't grow in the southwest. There's a few areas in Mesoamerica that it grows in the coastal plains off of Veracruz and stuff. And it seems to be being traded in and being used as a ritual drink. And I'll come back to that in a little bit. But so these are things which are not available to the average person out here, but are involved, they involve a network of exchange that was probably structured around movement and contacts between elite groups within these cultures and within the societies. Because these things are moving in a different level, a different things, these are not like if you were looking at the exchange of cotton or you're looking at the exchange of some of the obsidian and things like that, more utilitarian types of things. This is on a different level than that. With that kind of in mind, the second page in here that you'll see is a map of pretty much the southwestern U.S. and northwest Mexico that kind of illustrates the major trade routes as they are entering into this region. And you'll see that there are structured, there's some that are coming from the California coast, some coming out from some south from Mexico and from the Gulf of California, and some that come from the Mississippi drainages and the Gulf of Mexico. The one region that we don't seem to have major trade routes coming into is so far that have been identified is from the north. And when you think about it, that's going to be up in the Rocky Mountains and into the Great Basin. You would have had some trade, but there's not quite the same structure, the same types of resources up there that would have been in demand for elites. Although there is turquoise coming in from that area. You know, I'll come back to that in a bit. As you see, these routes are numbered, and then the guideline to these things are in the next page as to how those routes moved and what was kind of moving along them. If you think in terms of most of the ones going to California and going out to the east, you're talking about essentially our interstate highway system now. The interstate system was built upon trade routes that were known in the American West, and those were built upon trade routes which were known to the Spaniards. And those were built upon trade routes that were known to the Native American populations. These routes have long histories. Interstate 10 here essentially is the one that runs through Blythe, and I think that one is essentially PC3. The I-8 route is PC4. I-40 is to the north. These routes have a great deal of antiquity and go back. I was asked earlier what I thought was some of the earliest trade routes in region. Probably the earliest that I can think of actually is not shown so much directly on here is the one that connected the Gulf of, or the California coast with the Great Basin region. That was established and was going back about 5,000 BC. The shell was moving from the coast up into the Great Basin And in some of the danger cave and some of those places in there, you'll have, there is shell that is found in those areas. In the southwest, your trade routes really start to be developed around 1200 BC in the beginning of the San Pedro phase, when you start to get agricultural fields and agricultural groups in, and the populations become more sedentary. In the Tucson Basin, we have a series of sites that are along the Santa Cruz River, and those sites have a fair amount of shell in them. And a lot of that shell is coming from the California coast. A lot of it is abalone and a few other species that are native to the California coast. Probably about 80% of it is coming out of the Gulf of California, but about 20% is coming from California. That route, that is establishing a lot of the trade systems at that point. The trade networks at that point probably are more or less sort of what we call down the line. You have groups of people who are trading, and then they trade on further on down and stuff. So you don't have necessarily an individual that's traveling the full length. It's just moving through a system of exchange going along. Later on, I think that's going to change, and we'll get to that in a bit. But that down-the-line kind of trade structure exists for a long time, really up until about 8900 or so. So you've got about 2,000 years where you have this down-line trade system that's going on. And this would incorporate the Hohokam, the early years of the Hohokam. It involves into some of the basket maker groups that you may be familiar with up on the plateau and stuff. And you have trade, it's linking all these areas, but it's not really highly structured. But we know, for instance, in sites up in the Petrified National Forest, there is shell that is coming out of the Gulf of California. And there's a couple of burials there that have a tremendous amount of shell that is involved in them, and necklaces of bilobed and disc beads that are carved out of the shell. But it doesn't appear that it's a very highly structured or highly controlled system. Around 900, you see development of a couple of more complex systems. You have the rise, the beginning of the Chaco system coming in. You have the rise of some of the great houses up there. The Mimbres seem to be coming more involved in stuff. And then in the Hohokam region, you start to get sites with the ball court system structure, so you may have market sort of structures there that are going on. And so you get a lot more of a kind of a different, it's still not highly regimented, but it's a more organized type of exchange. And it's at this time that you start to see sort of more exotic materials coming in. Shell has always been there, but it's at this time you start to see macaws coming in. Recent dating on macaws at Chaco, where we used to think most of the macaws dated to around 1000 AD or a little bit later. Now we're finding that there was two groups of macaw burials that date back to the late 800s and early 900s. And this is when they first established Chaco, the great house at Pueblo Bonito. And this has led Patty Crown and some people to suggest that it's possible that the acquisition of these exotic resources, these exotic materials, helped to establish the concept of certain people as being leaders and having specialized roles and significant positions in the society, and you start to get this sort of stratification of society. And as well as when you think about it in terms of organizing populations, if you go off, you go out on a pilgrimage, and the macaws would have been coming from the Gulf Coast or the Gulf of Mexico coast of Mexico down in Tamaulipas or into the Central Valley there. But if you go off to a pilgrimage and you're gone for a while and you come back with this brightly plumaged bird that you have trained to talk, and if, depending on whether you're real smart, you may have trained it to mimic certain types of phrases and stuff, that would give people the impression that you have access to a different level of communication to the spirits and to controlling and the environment. And you could organize your population a lot easier if they saw you as in terms of a sort of a significantly different individual with a lot more power and authority. And you start to see this sort of establishment of hierarchical systems. It's not by accident that the room in central part of Pueblo Bonito has a series of burials of 14 individuals, which are just incredibly rich. I mean, we're talking in excess of 52,000 pieces of turquoise with these, just coating these people. There are, I want to say, 14 macaw burials with these individuals, copper bells, copper other types of things. Some of the cylindrical vessels start to show up at this time. So you start to see the establishment of stratified societies. You start to see this type of elites, the development of an elite structure and elite populations. And so Chaco becomes a major center for this. Following that, we see down to the south, the members area, there's basically a reorganization, and this is when you start to see at 900 is when you see the members move into surface structures, taking on more of a Puebloan type of lifestyle. Black and white pottery is much more important. And this may reflect trade connections and interaction with the north and with Chaco. Because the members, one of the things that you'll see is in members pottery are images of people with macaws and people handling macaws. The members seem to have played a role as a mid person in terms of a lot of this exchange. And so you see their lifestyle, their types of villages are shifting out of Pueblo, out of pit houses into these more Puebloan types of structure. In the Hohokam region, you have, as I said, you have the ball court villages, which I know that Dave Abbott has been arguing have been a much more of a kind of a market kind of economy in a lot of these places, a more structured type of economy. And the Hohokam are probably exchanging into the up into the Mogollon region and up into the Flagstaff region. Most of the material for Chaco is probably coming through the members. We don't know how much contact was going on. We do know that the Hohokam and the members were in contact. We have a set of very remarkable shell individuals, carved shell images of people that show up at a site in the Gila Bend area, and that part of that cache that was in Gila Bend is replicated by shell that shows up at a site in the members' valley, Nan Ranch ruin. And they could be lost in these sets of material. So we're pretty certain that they were at least communicating a fairly fair amount. So in terms of the networks and things on that line, when the Chaco system sort of starts to goes through a reorganization at around 1150 or so, and you see the outliers becoming more established. It looks like there's networks of kind of parent-child relationships in terms of these villages or these centers, the great houses. And you also see the establishment of Wapatki and up in outside of Flagstaff. Wapatki is kind of an interesting place because it seems to be an established community that I want to say the center, that is really in place as a way of controlling exchange networks. You have things, features like Wupaki has a ball court. It also has a great kiva. You have architectural elements that are associated, one with the Ho'okam and the other with the Anasazi or the Puebloan groups. And the evidence would suggest that the Wupaki is more of a Puebloan group. Certainly the Great Kiva is central to the community, whereas the ball court is on the edge of the community. And you see that in a number of Sanawa sites up in that region around Flagstaff at that time. Wupaki has 32 macaw burials that were found. It has a tremendous amount of, a number of copper bells, a lot of shell, and a lot of other types of high status material. And it looks like it's kind of coordinating and being what Wilcox has referred to as entrepont, or entry port for the trade networks to come in and move through. And so it's controlling the trade into that region. Eventually, the Chaco structure kind of fails around 1200, and it sort of drops out. And you see a drop off in this trade network of elite materials and high status goods for about 50 years or so, and then it starts to pick up again. But you have a different system that comes into power. And in the 1300s, you have the rise of Pacame in Chihuahua. And that system is then established. And you see, again, this sort of fluorescence of trade network and trade coming in with high status goods moving up. At that time, you see a lot of turquoise. Pacame is raising macaws, which had not been done in the region before. There's some question of whether or not they were doing any types of metallurgy. Certainly, Charlie DePeso thought they were. Other people have argued quite persuasively that they probably weren't. But they certainly had access to and had a fair amount of the copper bells and stuff. What's interesting that takes place during this period, this hiatus, is that there's a change in some of the technology that was going on. Prior to this hiatus around 1200, the copper bells were made mainly from native copper and was very simple forms and things. After that, you get very elaborate types of copper because they're now working with alloys. So they're adding in tin and various other types of metals to strengthen it and make it more malleable and a little more easy to work. And so you start getting these very wired types of materials. In the handouts, I've given you some of the back pages. There's a page that shows some of the different copper bells and the styles that you have. The early copper bells are these little globular bells that are kind of at the top of the line. And as you can see, the lower part of that larger print, these guys down here, and these ones are much more elaborate. And that's because they're now working with alloys, and they can do things like this sort of elaborate sort of turtle bell that is from Pacame. There's also one of these from it's over by Safford area. Off the top of my head, I can't remember the name, but there was another turtle bell from that area. The large bell in the top picture here is from a classic period site that's called, not surprisingly, the Big Bell site. It's very similar to this one from Nayarit, the smaller one like that. Unfortunately, the Big Bell site is no longer in existence, so we don't really know what else was there, but it clearly had some contact, some fairly high status goods that were there. It got plowed away by one of the copper companies. Now, the other thing that takes place during that hiatus is your macaws and stuff they stop being traded. And then, as I said, when Pacame comes in, it's starting to raise. And we have at Casa Grande, you've got nesting boxes. And we know that they were raising turkeys and macaws in those boxes. We have eggs, we have fledglings, and you also have adult macaws. Generally, most of the macaws in the Southwest don't get to full maturity. Macaws, almost, I think, 90% of the macaw burials that we get, the macaws are between 10 and 12 months of age, 11 to 12 months of age. And the reason that is that's when they first get their full plumage. And it looks like when they get the full plumage, which would have been in the spring, and the theory is that it may be tied to the equinox, they would pluck the feathers and ritually kill the birds, and then bury the birds in pits that were prepared for this purpose. And it was probably part of a ritual process. Birds are extremely important to the Southwestern populations. Prayer feathers and the various ritual types of uses of feathers and things along that line. The average individual might need a couple of hundred feathers a year for their various prayer feathers, their pajos, various other types of things, and utilitarian needs, fletchings for arrows and things along that line. For a ritual, somebody who is a high status individual, they may need as much as 800 feathers in a year, of different types of feathers. And so you find, last night in Tucson, we had a presentation by Lori Webster, who's looking at perishable objects, and they were using everything down to juncos and other types of towies and things like that, and they would actually skin the bird and then wrap it into blankets and stuff. Feathers were used for everything that were very highly sought. The macaws, because of their bright feathers and stuff, and the fact that they were, vocalization and stuff like that, were probably at the very top of the need. I showed a picture in here of a macaw burial that was taken from the floor of one of the rooms that got Grasshopper Pueblo. And you can see that they're very carefully placed. This was all that the animal was carefully put into the floor, the pit in the floor, and then covered over and sealed. And so when the archaeologists found it, they just basically jacketed and lifted it out to show how it was structured. But you can see that it's all carefully put, kind of compressed into the pit. So shell, as I was said before, shell is the stuff that first shows up. It's first stuff, elite, exotic material that's exchanged around that we know of. And it goes back, like I said, to about 1200 BC. Shell plays different roles in different parts of the Southwest. Among the Hohokam, shell is pretty much ubiquitous. Most Hohokam probably had bracelets with them. I've sometimes suggested that bracelets were probably so ubiquitous that in order to be considered truly a Hohokam, you probably had to have at least one or two of them. Other types of shell ornaments, though, are not. And certain types of shell that seem to have been exchanged at a different level. And some of those are things like shell trumpets. One of those, you get trumpets that are made from murex and also from strombus. And there's some pictures of some of the strombus ones on the second page of the shell. This is down here. And those seem to mimic the distribution of the macaws a lot. What's one question would then is usually asked, what is being traded the other direction? If you've got all this stuff coming from outside of the region, the copper coming in from the south, the shell coming in, although shell was pretty much ubiquitous to the Hohokam, but you get beyond Hohokam, shell becomes much more restricted and much more of an elite material. Macaws are coming in, cacao's coming in, various other types of material. And what most people have suggested was moving south, and a lot of this was turquoise. Turquoise is material that is of highly sought after in Mesoamerica, but it has a very limited distribution in terms of where it occurs. It's a copper-based mineral, as many of you know, and it's really concentrated. The sources for turquoise in North America are really concentrated in the southwest and northwest Mexico. Recent work in Mexico City at the Temple Mayor is showing that while turquoise was highly sought after, they were really trying to get any kind of blue-green stone that they could use, but turquoise was certainly the most desirable of the material. Most of what they were wanting it in actual form is as mosaic tessera. They would build very elaborate mosaics. And I've got some examples of some of the mosaics in the southwest here that are depicted. The turquoise in Mesoamerica was probably prized more than your metals, your gold and silver and stuff. The symbol for life in Nahuatl is actually the symbol that is for turquoise. When Cortez landed along the coast of Veracruz and Montezuma sent his emissaries, what they took, the offer to Cortez, who was, they thought maybe might be this god returning, were turquoise mosaics. Unfortunately for the turquoise mosaic, they were mounted on gold plaque. And so the emissaries were rather horrified by the fact that the Spaniards would pull the turquoise off and go after the gold, which is probably part of why they then decided they weren't so godlike. So I guess that kind of gives us a framework, and then we can talk about any questions or things on this.
The macaws, was their longevity based on the fact they were coming out of a high humid jungle into the dry desert southwest, and therefore they didn't live that long, or they didn't produce, they weren't as prolific as they were in the right. High humidity?
The question is, why was the lifespan of the macaws kind of truncated at about a year down the line? And we know that they did not raise them in the southwest except at Pacame, and probably the reason why they didn't try to raise them was because they were so fragile. As fledglings, these birds are very, very susceptible to if they get chilled. I think so that they die very easily as very young birds. But that point at when they reach 12 months, that's when they first get their full plumage. And that's what we think they were being brought up for. Aside from their ability to mimic human speech, this plumage would have been highly prized. And it's at that point that they're being sacrificed. There was only, I think, in terms of the outside of Pacame, there's only about three or four adults that were in a breeding age, which is 3 to 4 years, that have been identified. So they just didn't let them get that old.
You mentioned Paki. I guess it's up north towards Flagstaff. I'd never heard of that place.
Pacame?
I've actually been to Pacame, no, but I'd never heard of the other.
Oh, Wapaki.
Wapaki.
Yeah, Wapaki.
Okay, that's in the Flagstaff area?
That's in the Flagstaff area.
Which was first?
Wapaki is about 1,200 to about 1,300, and Pacame is about 1,300 to 1,450.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I know even in today's times, the Zuni trap eagles and ritually smother them and pluck them. So that feather thing has lasted a long time.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if there's any current sources for parrots or macaws, but you see it, if you go to powwows at all, you'll see a lot of Indians are wearing mostly eagle feathers, sometimes hawk feathers. Occasionally, you'll see macaw feathers, because I've seen them. But whether other people ritually kill them, I don't know.
Yeah. It's thought that probably the idea of the smothering is something that actually Sharman Machusik has suggested was the ritual way that these macaws were being killed when they were plucked. The role of birds in general in southwestern groups, even today, is very important, because you use the feathers as part of your prayer sticks and things along that lines, your pajos and other types of stuff. And when Judd excavated in the 30s at Pueblo Bonito in Chaco Canyon, he visited Zuni, and he said that there were four macaws there then at Zuni, one of which died during his period, and he made a lot of good friends when he went and got them another macaw. The demand for the birds and for things that continues, eagles have become more and more important symbols in terms of this. During the prehistoric period, you don't see eagles as much. The big one is actually turkey feathers. A lot of turkey feathers show up. But macaw feathers show up in some very, very limited but very highly ritual kinds of context. There's some macaw feather, and partially because you just don't, it's not preserved well. Feathers don't last out in open archaeological sites. But in some of the cave sites up, say, in the Grand Gulch area, they have aprons which had macaw feathers woven into them, and other types of ritual kind of paraphernalia, wands or fans and things like that that use macaw feathers.
The roots that you have depicted on your map here,
mm-hmm.
were those roots constant throughout the ages?
No.
Okay, so...
Some of them seem to be more or less constant, and other ones come and go.
Did the Spaniards use some of these same roots
because
already existing?
Yes. The routes that come from the south, that come out of the Rio Bavispe and up the Rio Mayo and stuff, I think they're... I have to look at my chart.
That's out of the Gulf?
That's out of the Gulf, yeah. The G5 one, a variant of that is probably the one that Coronado followed.
Okay.
He was being guided by native guides, and they were using the trails that they were familiar with.
Okay.
And I should say that after Pacame collapsed in around 1450 or so, Carol Riley, who's an archaeologist who's worked in northern Mexico, has suggested that some of the areas of Sinaloa and Sonora tried to more or less just take up that. And they established small statelets in that area. And so when Coronado was coming up, he was moving through those areas. We don't know exactly the route that he followed, although the Flints have been doing a lot of work to try to reconstruct that.
And it looks like most of the routes follow rivers.
Most of them follow rivers, which, in the desert regions, water is important. Now, the one big one that's an exception to that is the one coming out of the northern part of the Gulf, is that big broad arrow there. And that is probably actually the major shell trade route coming into the Hohokam region. And that comes across the western Papagueria, the area around to the west of Sells. And there you have a lot of sites that are campsites out there and some villages that are seasonal at best. Where you have production, just huge amounts of shell production. That's mostly shell in that one.
Arthur, could you comment on the shell bracelets? Are they used by men, women, children? Are there special contexts that they're recovered in?
Yeah, it looks like, among the Hohokam, we'll start with the Hohokam, shell bracelets are pretty much we'll step back before Hohokam to the San Pedro, to the late archaic, what we call early agricultural period. You have no shell bracelets. You have lots of other types of shell, beads and pendants, but no shell bracelets. When the ceramic era comes in and you start to see the beginnings of ceramic technology, all of a sudden shell bracelets are there. And it looks like it's a tradition that comes out of northwest Mexico. Down in Michoacan, in that area, you have a long tradition of shell bracelets. That said, everybody has shell bracelets. It goes from about zero in the early agricultural to 70% of the assemblage. And it's a remarkable change, and I don't understand yet what its significance is. Within the Hohokam, pretty much you get burials. When you do get inhumations in the pre-classic, infants will have shell bracelets. Everybody, it's throughout. I mean, it's both men, women were wearing them. As you get into the classic period of the Hohokam, there becomes an interesting dichotomy. And unfortunately, we don't have enough burials in the pre-classic to know whether this was true. There's mostly cremations, so you don't get to see the placement on the person. But in the classic period, males would wear the bracelets. They're actually more of an armlet type of things. They're heavier, and they're worn on the upper left arm. Females, adult females, would wear bracelets around the wrist, usually also on the left wrist. And I think this is in part because most people are right-handed. It's not going to get as battered by the motion. I think it's a practical thing, but it's a really striking pattern that we saw in the Tonto Basin burials that we were looking at a couple of years ago for the Tonto Basin project. And De Peso found it at some of the sites down at Palo Parado, what he was calling San Cayetano de Tumacacri, which nobody now thinks is San Cayetano, but it's now called Palo Parado. But he had that same pattern. When you get outside of the Hohokam region, it changes. Bracelets become much more restricted. They're an elite material. You will get burials that will have multiple bracelets, and they'll just line the arms with it. There was one individual at the Harris site, which is a pre-classic members site, that had 23 bracelets on one arm, and seven, I think, on the other. It's much more of an elite product, an elite good, and it's much more restricted in terms of its social distribution. In the Anasazi region, northern Pueblos, you have bracelets are found in up to P3. It would be up to the beginning of P3, bracelets are found fairly commonly in sites and are found a lot in burials. And again, it's not everybody has them. There are a lot are found with a few individual types of things. What's interesting that takes place is that in Pueblo three times, bracelets drop out. There's virtually no bracelets found. And it's in the same areas. For instance, in the area around Zuni, Tiatutlana, which is a site that's a P1, P2 site, had a lot of bracelets. Village of the Great Kiva, which is not that far from it, had many burials, but had no bracelets. It had other types of shell, beads and pendants. What I think that's reflecting is this shift in trade networks that took place. In P3, you were dealing with that network that was coming up through the members into Chaco and across. And prior to that, you would have been dealing with the Hohokam networks that were coming up from the south.
I was asked to ask a question about, are there any of the shell artifacts that are either abundant enough or standardized enough that they may have actually been serving as money?
I don't know that we can really say on that. Bracelets would be one that would be standardized, but however, it's going to be difficult to say. There is some, I mean, in California, various types of shell beads were used essentially as money. Some of the Olivella disc beads and stuff. And it's quite possible that some of the types of beads or something along that line might have served as something along this line. But as a standardized monetary unit, I don't know that we have enough to say that.
I had a question on the map. Are the routes just for the elite products, or is there overlap with, you know, more everyday trading?
The routes that we show here are probably ones that everything, you know, things moved along through the along these routes in general. So everyday types of things would have been exchanged. But if you were to take the everyday types of materials, it would have been kind of much broader. I mean, all of this whole region would have been exchanging. You have villages exchanging back and forth and stuff along that line. So it isn't quite as defined. These are routes that were really defined by nodes along that had elites and elite evidence for elite occupations. One of the things which these are based on, and I kind of didn't really talk about it too much, was if you see a set of these maps that we have in the middle here, the distribution that's being shown here between the different styles of lines is the distribution for the copper bells, for the macaws, for types of the strombus and some of the shell ritualized shell use. And you can see how they overlap. These things have a very, they overlap and they kind of reflect this network of nodes where traders would have taken place and would have been going through, bringing elite materials in. And you can kind of see how these things are tied together. To give you an idea of some of the trade networks. In the classic period, you probably had individuals that were moving through who were trading these things. This was not a down-the-line trade network after 8900. You're dealing with people who were specialists in trading this material and bringing things in and making the linkages between the elites from different communities and stuff. There's an interesting bit that kind of reflects this. There's a type of shell pendant bead that was made in California, made out of what they call the large limpets, megathura. Squalita. But it's a large limpet, and they would make rings out of these things, out of the outer edges of the limpet. I found three sites that have those. They're all right in a line in the Tucson Basin. Rabbit Ruin, Los Moteros, and I think we had some up at, I can't think of the third one, but it's right at that point in the northern Tucson Basin. Only a few of them are found, but they're all right together in one set of burials at each of these sites. Looks like it was one person that came in with these things. And they exchanged them, and then they ran out. What's interesting is that at Los Moteros, you have counterfeits that are being made, where they're taking the back of glycerous shells, which are a bivalve, and they're grinding them down and then shaping them to look like these things. And those were found in another set of burials, and one that actually had both in it. Some of these things are kind of probably single events that were, you know, they were special. They were high status, you know, objects, and they were trying to emulate them.
Isn't there a comparative kind of thing? Wasn't there shell trade in South America?
Oh, yes.
Africa?
Yeah.
And from which you can glean conclusions, mm-hmm. comparisons, that kind of thing, yeah. to bring in?
I mean, in Africa, you have a huge shell trade in the west coast of, or east coast of Africa, off of the Madagascar coast and stuff, where there was a huge shell trade system structured around cowries. And in the Indo-Pacific, you've got the whole Kula ring that Malinowski talks about, where they were trading certain types of shell in a very elite structure type of thing. So you have, there's a lot of models that you can look at for this type of elite trade networks that were going on that involve shell or other types of material. Bracelets in pre-Bronze Age Greece, bracelets were a big thing, shell bracelets. Made out of the Mediterranean glycerous shell.
I'm wondering if if there's any evidence for use of thick-billed parrots, which were found in Arizona, mm-hmm. or did they always kind of skip past for the exotic macaws?
You have the Mexican thick-billed parrot that is a green, has a green plumage. It looks a lot like military macaw, but it's smaller. And yes, you do get some thick-billed parrots being traded. They're not as extensive. And I'm trying to think of some of the sites that had thick-billed. I think Galez in the Mimbres area had some couple of thick-billed parrots. I don't know if there's any in the Chaco region, but I think some of the stuff in some of the southern Arizona types of areas. I think the thick-billed parrot occurred as far north as I know as Tucson. I don't know how much further up it came, but it was there. It's a fairly minor portion when you compare it to some of the things. There's roughly 500 some odd burials of macaws known, of which 400 are in Pacame, so it kind of takes out your sample. Your sample is pretty low when you get into it, but I think there's maybe 20 thick-billed parrots known, something along that line.
Okay, copper bells. Mm-hmm. What's their source? Were any made in the Southwest and then traded out, or is it all coming from Mexico? And is it some specific place in Mexico? I mean, that's a pretty elaborate system.
Oh, yeah. And it's actually, it's even more elaborate than you realize. Metallurgy starts in South America. In terms of the New World, the metallurgy started in the highlands of South America, and highland Peru and Ecuador. It moves up the coast, and it comes into Mesoamerica at around AD 800. Some people have suggested as early as 600, but it's certainly in West Mexico around AD 800. And then the first copper bells start to show up in the Southwest sometime around AD 1000. So it's something that was linked up. And what brought the South American groups up the west coast of Central America was shell. They were coming up looking for spondylus. And so they brought the knowledge of metallurgy as they were looking for shell connecting. So that's when I was talking about the large scale of this thing. When you start putting all the little components together, it keeps going out there. There's no evidence for this is basically a lost wax process. And the early years, it was, as I said, it's basically using native copper to process and things. And then about 1200, they start using alloys, and they can do a lot more elaborate stuff. But there's no evidence that it was ever the technique and the knowledge was actually in the Southwest at that point. It was always coming in as finished objects. And it wasn't just bells. They would make other things. There were some needles and some tweezer types of things that have been found, but those are mostly restricted to Pacame and some of the other late sites, but mostly it's bells. Interesting that if the bells drop out and they don't show up in the Southwest assemblages after the fall, after Pacame drops out around 1400, 1450, but you do start seeing clay imitation bells. Clay things that are shaped into bells and then are fired to look like bells. So the knowledge of those things stuck around for a long time.
If you're willing to go a little further afield in the other direction, is there any evidence for any kind of trade between the Southwest and the Mississippian areas?
Oh, yes. probably the strongest evidence, I mentioned the holly as being impossible thing coming in from the floodplain of the Gulf of Mexico material. That's only been recently identified, and so we don't really understand what the significance of that. But that occurred both at Chaco and at Snake Town and in the Mimbres site. So it's this residue that they're finding. They found it when they started looking for cacao residues, and they found this other stuff. Now, holly, I don't know if many of you are familiar with holly, but the berries that you see on holly are highly toxic. So it's not the berries that they're doing. What they were doing was crushing up the leaves and the twigs and then boiling that. And even then, it's not a good thing to drink. It, what the ritual was a purging ritual. You drink it, hold it for a while, and then you would vomit it. And that's why the species is actually called vomitaria. I forget what. But there seems to be the residues in some of these vessels, these ritual-looking vessels, the cylindrical pots in the Chaco region, and some of the pots, some of the vessels from the Hohokam area. There does seem to be this holly material. So that's coming in. We have a burial at Spiro Mound that had 1,200 Olivella Dama beads. And now Olivella Dama occurs in the northern Gulf of California. So we have shell going all the way across out into that area. We know that at the time of Spanish contact, you know, Pecos Pueblo was actively involved in this east-west route, getting hides and buffalo hides and stuff out of the Gulf, out of the Plains Indians, and were trading shell and other types of material for this material. And quite possibly those hides were then moving south too. When you look at the Spanish accounts, Father Kino talks about macaws coming in. He doesn't say the macaws, but Father Velarde, who was the priest at Son of del Bach, actually talks about, uses the Mexican word for macaw. And he identifies them, and he talks about their red plumage, so they're scarlet macaws. So this network is just, you know, it's when you start looking at all the little parts and following them out, that's huge.
Most of the Spanish missions had bells, and they use it for calling
the horse stack.
Yes.
Yeah.
Were those Indian forged bells, or they were Spanish?
Those were Spanish forged. Okay. And actually, that ties into what you think of as Indian arts and crafts nowadays with all the silver work and stuff. That came out of being trained, Indians that were trained by the Spaniards to make the horse tack types of stuff. So that starts, again, it's kind of a reinvention of work, a metallurgy that was being worked.
Was the shell trade to the east, to the Mississippi, primarily for the elite? And where are some of the areas that they were found to the east of, say, New Mexico?
Yeah. We don't really have that many deposits we know about. But certainly the one that I know about at Spiro was an unusual deposit of, you know, a huge number of beads that were going into this guy. And he was definitely an elite individual. He had a lot of other types of material with him.
What was that again?
That was at Spiro Mounds in Oklahoma. The other thing that's coming in from the Texas area is there's a type of freshwater shell, and I can't remember the name of the type, but it's a very heavy freshwater type of bivalve that occurs down there that you find in the Puebloan area. You find sites where these, it's a nacreous interior, you find pendants and things made out of it there. It's a type of mussel. It's a unio mussel. I can't think of the name. It starts with a C, is the genus name. Meant to look it up before I came and forgot.
If there's one more question, we can squeeze it in. One more here.
Just on one of the artifacts on your page, it says elaborate crotal from,
yes,
Pakime. Okay, can you describe that a little more? I mean, the picture's not real great.
The picture, what that is a, it's a, crotal is another term for a copper bell, basically, is things. And the one that is depicted is a shape, it's been shaped into a looking like a turtle. And Q Ranch is the other site plate, has a turtle. In a private collection from Q Ranch, there's a turtle bell as well. But yeah, it's shaped into a turtle. And the fact that it was made using the alloys allowed it to be shaped and more detailed designed as opposed to the simple globular bells, and that's probably the most elaborate that I've ever seen was the turtle bells.
I'm just wondering, I'm a hiker, backpacker, you know, I've hiked all over the place, and I'm going, okay, You have all of your trails there, and we're talking about trade from, you know, let's say New Mexico to Arizona to the Gulf. Let's say shells, for example. What's happening? You know, like at Wapatki, are the people in Wapatki going, hey, we need some shells, and they're walking all the way down to the coast and picking them up and coming them back, and they're governing it that way? Or are they trading? Are the people on the coast collecting the shell, taking it in? And where is it manufactured? You know, you know, do you know
anything about it? Well, it varies for time somewhat, but certainly shell from, say, the Gulf of California, you had groups that were in the Gila Bend area and along the sort of periphery. Snaketown is another, is one of these sites. The Gila Bend site, or Gatlin, I couldn't remember the other name for it. But those sites, it looks like people were going down to the coast and bringing material back. Now, there are some sites that occur out in the Papagoria that seem to be seasonal types of things that probably were existed, say, late spring period or something along that line, or fall. Probably not in the dead of summer. But we do have evidence for, say, corn being grown there, so they were there for a while. But these sites were out at the northern part, but in the Papagoria, in the Growler Valley and in the San Cristobal Valley. And these sites would have been part of this network. But there, you get these campsites where they were reducing the shell as they were coming back and things, but then they would go in and then it spreads out. For the California material, it's probable that they were trading more finished work, although certainly abalone was being traded as whole valves. There's a burial outside of Sanavir at the Sanavir Mission Bridge site where there was an individual, he had a conch trumpet, a strombus trumpet on his chest and a whole abalone shell on his stomach. He also had a quiver, well, what we think was a quiver because we have claws of a mountain lion down kind of on the side and a lot of projectile points along his side. This guy was definitely a high-status individual. One thing about trumpets, which is interesting, that I didn't talk about, was their role seems to change in time. In the pre-classic, when you do get trumpets, they're in burials. They're in cremations, with one exception that I can think of, which is a trumpet that was found at Snaketown, and it was in a disturbed area, so we're not real certain where it was. But most of them are burned, they're in burials and cremations. The earliest trumpets we have in the Southwest is actually from a site in the Tucson Basin that is called the Coastline site, but it's really part of a larger site complex of Redtail, where there were two burials with strombus that date to late CDO, early Rito period, around AD 800 or so. Interestingly, that site had a tremendous amount of turquoise. It's one of the earliest turquoise manufacturing sites, too. But when you get in the classic period, you get the platform mounds. Trumpets are not found in burials. They're found associated with the platform mound. So the role of the trumpet changes. It becomes more of a ritual object that is related to the rituals being performed at the mound, and it does not belong to the individual that is performing that ritual, it belongs to the ritual itself. After the collapse of the platform mound system, it goes back to be found with burials, and found in this particular case at Sanavir, it was found with an individual of a high status. So it goes back to being associated with the role of the individual.
Thank you, Arthur, for sharing your amazing information. Yeah.